Welcome. Welcome and take this moment to make room for the Creator of the world to draw near. Let God be in the breaths we take, in the words we hear and speak and sing, as well as in the silence. Come to find your hearts healed and your imagination stirred. Come to experience forgiveness and inspiration. Come to sit with God and to discover your very special place in God's heart, a heart with room for everyone. Lord God, our Heavenly Father, before you, we realize just how many are our faults and our failings. Your love stops at nothing. Ours is so much more conditional. Your patience is endless, while ours is short-lived. You want to care with no strings, while we care on our terms, when it suits, and when it doesn't ask too much. But these, Father God, these are things that you already know, and yet you still choose to love us and to care for us and to call us, as well as entrusting us with your gospel. In utter amazement at the risks you take in working with us, we praise you this day with full hearts. Help us always to be aware of the privilege it is to be held in your heart, and give us, we pray, the courage to let you slowly reshape and transform us. May the forgiveness you offer us turn us around and point us in a new direction, one in which, with you, we discover what matters and we set aside what doesn't. Take us, we pray, out of ourselves to see the bigger picture you have in mind and to welcome others into it. These things we ask in the name of our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, your Son, who taught us when we pray to say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
good shepherd who is willing to die for the sheep. When the hired man, who is not a shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees a wolf coming, he leaves the sheep and runs away. So the wolf snatches the sheep and scatters them. The hired man runs away because he's only a hired man and does not care about the sheep. I am the good shepherd. As the Father knows me and I know the Father, in the same way I know my sheep and they know me, and I'm willing to die for them. There are other sheep which belong to me that are not in this sheep pen. I must bring them too. They will listen to my voice and they will become one flock with one shepherd. The Father loves me because I am willing to give up my life in order that I may receive it back. No one takes my life away from me. I give it up of my own free will. I have the right to give it up, and I have the right to take it back. This is what my Father has commanded me to do.
Sheep and shepherds come up quite a lot in the Bible, don't they?
They seem to. The Lord's my shepherd and all that.
And here's Jesus declaring himself to be the good shepherd.
Aye, and if you were to read the whole of that chapter from John, you'd hear a lot more about shepherding.
How so?
Well, Jesus talks about the shepherd being the gate to the sheepfold where the sheep are kept. Any shepherd worth their salt will make sure no one and nothing gets in to harm their flock. They'll be on the lookout for anything from sheep stealers to wild animals. And a shepherd will also be the one who lets the sheep in and out.
So why on earth would you want to let your sheep out? Is it not easier to care for them and keep them safe when they're in the pen?
We're talking here about the Middle East. There aren't any of the lush green fields you see around here. For the sheep to thrive, a shepherd has to find where grass is growing, and he or she then has to physically take the sheep there. Then the shepherd has to watch over those sheep while they're out, making sure they don't come to any harm or wander off where they shouldn't.
Jeez, it's a full-time job, isn't it?
It is, even today.
I'm not sure, though, there are too many farmers around here who are willing to die for their sheep. It's a bit extreme, isn't it?
We're talking about different days and times. Back then, sheep were all a shepherd had. They were his life and his livelihood. Without them, he or she wouldn't survive, and neither would their family. They needed the sheep for milk and for meat to eat, and also to sell.
No diversification back then?
Nope. Which makes the shepherd's job a really important one.
What I don't get is Jesus eyeing up other people's sheep. Do you think he's got any border genes?
Eh?
Didn't border reavers raid and steal other people's animals and whatever else they could get their hands on? And if you were a victim, you had 6 days to mount a retaliation to retrieve your sheep and cattle.
I really don't think Jesus was into sheep rustling, and neither was he into retaliation for sheep rustling or for anything else. What on earth made you think that?
The reading.
The reading?
Yeah, didn't you hear it? After the bit about his being prepared to die for his sheep, Jesus said quite clearly that he had other sheep not in the pen that he needed to reclaim.
Let me check the reading again.
It's verse 16. Jesus says, "There are other sheep which belong to me that are not in this sheep pen. I must bring them too. They will listen to my voice and they will become one flock with one shepherd."
You do know Jesus is not actually talking about sheep, don't you?
Of course I do. So what's he talking about if it's not sheep?
Jesus is talking about the people he's prepared to give up his own life for.
He is?
He is. He's talking about the people he wants to care for and protect and watch over. Those he wants to feed and nurture and look after.
And who are those fortunate souls?
You and me, and every person in every time and place. We are all people Jesus cares deeply about.
No exceptions?
No exceptions.
Poor Jesus.
What do you mean?
Well, it must be worse than herding cats working with people.
I think you might be right. I think, too, we're going to hear more about that in a minute.
Okay, so why don't we pause there and sing the 23rd Psalm?
Great idea. Let's sing, "The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want."
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still, still waters. His goodness restores my soul. And I will trust in you. And I will trust in you alone. For your endless mercy follows me. Your goodness will lead me. Guides my ways in righteousness, and He anoints my head with oil, and my cup it overflows with joy. I feast on His pure. I will trust in you, and I will trust in you alone, for your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will lead me.
Jesus looks upon everyone as His, which means that for Him, everyone belongs under His wing as part of His flock. He described His shepherding role in lots of different ways. Just before the reading we heard, Jesus described Himself as a gate or a doorkeeper. No one, He said, could get into the sheepfold except through Him. Jesus was both the safe passage into the fold, and He was also the gate out of it to find fresh pastures. Through Jesus, the flock would come and go. It's strange how we seem to forget about the going out. We tend to focus on getting into the sheep pen as though that's all that matters, as though that is the ultimate goal in life. And we don't give very much thought to going out again. Yet the going out is every bit as important as the coming in. If the sheep were to stay penned in all the time, they'd have no freedom, they'd have no food and no life, really. Jesus wants so much more for each and every one of us. When he calls us into his flock, Jesus does so because he wants to set us free to truly live and to thrive and to be the best that we can be, which is an amazing thought, especially since whether we're coming or going, our shepherd, so we're told, is with us, going before us and behind and looking out for us always. So how come we have ended up thinking that the getting in is everything and that nothing else matters? I suspect that might be a consequence of our all too human tendency to do exactly what Jesus never did, which is to put ourselves first. We are all about me. And as time goes on, it seems we're getting even worse. I mean, how many parents want clubs and activities for their children and things for them to do, but they don't want to help at them or help to organise them? And neither do they want to commit to making sure that the children are there every week. That would be too tiring. How many want groups for older people or for the lonely, but expect other people to make these things happen? Lots of people long for a strong community spirit, but then they never turn up to support any community events. And there are those who would be up in arms if the church closed, but they'd never dream of coming. And we carry that individuality over into our faith. We want to be counted among Jesus' followers, but we're not so keen on being asked to do anything too much about living that faith out. We seem to expect others to do the talking and the leading, and everybody else to just tag along. Now, this is not a get at people. As I say, it seems to be just human nature. Jesus, however, challenges us to dare to think differently. That phrase Jesus spoke about there being more sheep not yet in the pen, whom he wanted brought in so that there would be one flock with one shepherd. Those words are pointing to what is Jesus' ultimate goal, which is for all people to know that they are wanted and are loved into life by him. And he is looking for us to work with him to pass that message on, which means getting out there. Faith is not, as we've been hearing every week since Easter, faith is not about hiding away and making sure we're okay. It's about trusting we're okay because of what Jesus has done and then letting that trust give us the courage to go out in Jesus' name into the world beyond to share a message that's needed as much now as ever it was, just as Peter and John did. Faith is about coming into the kingdom, but it's also about going out into the world, coming and going. There is no staying put.
Thank you.
Lord Jesus, our shepherd, Lord, and friend, we need to be guided in the paths we should take. Feed, we pray, our hungry souls, and lead us to find rest and hope and help. We need these things as individuals, as communities, as a church, a nation, and as a world. And coming into the safety of your loving embrace, inspire us, we pray, to find the courage to then go out again into your world to share your promises and truths. And thank you. Thank you for being with us when the paths we find ourselves on feel frightening or worrying or tough for us to follow. Thank you for taking our hand and for leading us through. Thank you for being the light we need to keep going. Continue to go before us, Lord, and behind. We bring you, Lord Jesus, our prayers for others who need to know how close you are. We pray for those growing used to living with the threat and with violence. We pray for children used to the sound of sirens and the sounds of shells falling. Lord, inspire us all to fight with as much passion to love one another in your name as a few do to sow the seeds of hatred. Let love triumph and let peace reign. We think of places in the UK and beyond affected by changing seasons, leading to drought, to flooding. Protect the vulnerable, we pray. Safeguard those whose livelihoods are at risk. And maybe look out for those facing hunger or coping with disease. Help us all, we pray, to care more for your world and to protect it more. We bring you the elderly who feel uncared for or left behind, as well as those of all ages who feel the darkness of depression. Father God, you hold every individual in your heart and share their pain and hurt, as well as their despair. And you promise to walk with each one through even the darkest valley. May they each know how close you are and feel your hand upon them. And help us all, we pray, to find the courage to let you care for us. May we know for sure you're always with us and know that your promise is eternal. Fill us, we pray, with the warmth of your blessing and help us to be that blessing to others. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Can you do without it? Are you sure? Thank you.